or magi following a star, whether this is your home or you've just arrived, you are welcome to bring your full self here. When we conclude, all are invited to stay and join us for warmth and fellowship, a traditional wassail in our Fletcher Hall, which is right here. But first, let us reach out to greet our nearest neighbors. Please share words of peace and welcome.
Thank you. beat our swords into plowshares. From Isaiah, the prophet that sought to deliver us from our apathy and our indifference. From Isaiah 29, speaking for the holy.
I will astonish these people with wonder after wonder. The wisdom of the wise will perish. The intelligence of the intelligent will vanish.
I will astonish these people
with wonder after wonder.
We stop. We pause. We pay attention. We arrive here out of the din of the everyday. We regain here that space, that place of wonder. We may even believe here that there is reason, reason to rise, to praise, to sing of something unreal and astounding. Please, rise and sing with us.
Thank you.
congregation. Earlier, this congregation, among other acts of care, earlier in the year, we used the money we collected at last year's Christmas Eve service to assist families so that they can stay in their homes. We aided our homeless friends with the means to wash, rest, and eat. And we provided families split by domestic violence with the means to care for their children. I say we, because this is the work we do together when we support the Care Fund. It's managed by our ministers of our congregation, and know that your gifts will be used appropriately and honorably. The Christmas Eve offering will now be collected.
Thank you.
You know, Luke has the only gospel account with the story of Jesus lying in a manger. And a manger is but a food trough, a place where they put the feed for the livestock. This comes from the second chapter of Luke. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. All went to their own towns. So Joseph went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because Joseph was descended from the house and family of King David. Joseph went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son. And she wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for him at the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And suddenly, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to those shepherds, "Be not afraid, for see, I bring you good tidings of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah. And when you go, this will be a sign for you. You will find that child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in the manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace and goodwill among all people." And when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem. Let us see this thing that has been told to us." And so they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and that child lying in a manger.
Thank you.
action as you are moved. Spirit of life and of love, stars that call us like shepherds out of the ordinary, to peer and see more than we could have imagined. God of our understanding, thank you for this night, for the blessing that we are here, that we have made it another year. Hold us close as we hold our family and our friends, and as we hold those tender memories, those memories especially of grief and loss at this time of year. Hold us as we hold tenderly to our own souls, souls troubled by grief or rejection, by wars or by anger, by sickness or strife. Allow us the space for peace. For peace if we are willing, and even perhaps for forgiveness. Forgiveness for not being the perfection that our souls so foolishly seek. And hold us awash in the lights and the darkness of this season. And hold us carefully as we yield just a bit of our skepticism, just a mote of our weariness, so we might remember, as the stars fly overhead and the candles flicker nearby, that we are loved, that we are loved, that we are loved. All of us loved for who and how we are, a part of this great mystery. May our private prayers and meditations deepen in a space of shared silence. Please share the word that moves in your soul. Amen. May it be so. Blessed be.
Thank you.
visit to the Magi, the Gospel of Matthew tells us that Mary and Joseph had to flee for their lives. This story is not always told. It's the dangerous part of the story. The gospel story explains that an angel appeared to Joseph in a dream and said in Matthew 2:13, "Get up, take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod the monarch, the Arvites, Herod is going to search for the child to kill him." So Joseph got up, took the child with Mary, fled for their lives to Egypt. Our second reading is by Victoria Emily Jones, a liberal Christian, and it speaks of this fear-filled flight. Hear the words. "What child is this who fled that night from Herod's wrathful order?" As Rachel wept, the family kept on pressing toward the border. This is Christ our King, a refugee, a stranger. Pray for all like him, the babe, the son of Mary.
Come on.
her some soul food. Some food to heal the broken places. Jesus was placed in a manger, as the story goes, placed in a manger in a food trough for the hay and the oats for the horses to eat. Right? Right? It's not just the choir of people I'm related to that get to respond. Come to the manger, the choir sang. Come to the manger, come and be fed. Not on Jesus, not literally. What kind of faith community do you think this is? But come and be fed on the promise, on the story. Jesus was placed in a food trough in a manger. A few days later, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph were refugees. They were refugees because Herod, that despot, that jealous despot, threatened to hunt them down. Jesus was a threat to Herod's rule. So they sought refuge in Egypt, which in 4 BC was outside the jurisdiction of Herod, a place, a traditional place, say the scholars, of refuge for the hunted. I wonder if those at our borders tonight see our nation as a modern Egypt, a safe haven. But more on that later, because I'm still hungry. I'm empty. I'm empty, and I am being fed on empty air. On sound bites, on news cycles that twist rudeness with rumor, politics on politics while children are being shot in our schools and caged at our border, and dark skin is still a life sentence or a license to abuse. Jesus, you know Jesus had dark skin. Are you hungry?
Yeah.
You stay hungry because there's work to be done. I'm hungry. And if you were there, and if we were there together, looking down on the face of a child, and the child's face, brown, pink, or otherwise, was bathed in the light of a brilliant star, if you had come to the manger, are you with me?
Yes.
Are you bringing me something? Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. If you had come to see the baby, if you had been told that years of darkness would end, that the Herods, the oppressors, would be overthrown not by another dictator and not by a partisan machine, but by a child? Are you still with me? If you had learned from saints, from seers, from elders, from rabbis, from the prophets on the streets of Jerusalem that there would be a Messiah, a Savior, and that the Messiah would be born a babe like any other, a child shall lead them, said Isaiah. And if you were looking down on the face of this child, and this child's face were bathed in the light of a brilliant star, a light that we now know by the grace of science, light that had been traveling for a millennia to make it there, right there, to that wretched stable, to that hovel of a birthing place, to shine even there. Would you then, would you know you were looking at the holy? At a blessing, at a sight with the power to save the world. And would you then feel full, satiated? Would you? Can you feel this? You see, I can see the holy there in that stable, in that place of rejection. Rejection, why do I call it a place of rejection? You see, that was Joseph's hometown, Bethlehem. As we heard in the Luke reading, So Joseph went from the town of Nazareth to the city of David called Bethlehem because he was descended from the house and the family of David. We skip over this sometimes. Does it matter, really? Does it matter? It matters because Joseph should have been known there. He was from there. He was from Bethlehem. I imagine him knocking, Joseph knocking on the doors, uncle, cousin, kin, friend. And Mary there, just behind him, straining with the first of the labor, doors shut, names called. What child is this, Joseph? You are not married. How dare you bring her to our door, to our border, to the line between us and them? Turned away until the only place left was a stable at an inn, and Mary aching with labor. So yes, I see the child and the child's face bathed in light of a distant star, and the wanderers who came there, the shepherds who never leave their flocks, who came there to rest their eyes on a child born out of wedlock, to bow, to adore, a family that had been turned away again and again, but there in the light they feasted as they were fed on promise. What child is this? You see, that's the difference. It's how you ask the question. I see that scene as a blessing, as the holy, as a sight with the wonder to feed this hungry world, and I take a bite and it fills me. Can you feel me? I still just mostly hear the choir. I can't stop there. I can't stop there with just one child, though, because I've been called to pass this story through my faith, and my faith, maybe your faith too, knows these ancient stories as metaphors that must point us, like that starlight that travels for a millennia, point us to wider and deeper truths, truths with the power, not to save that world of Herod and Mary, but our world that is hungry, so hungry this holy night. And you know what happens when the world gets hungry? It gets angry. And it starts to fear. Our world, a world of borders and barriers, a world of closed doors and burdened families, a world that shuts doors with sound bites, a world where starlight shines on children's faces not in mangers but in cages. A world where Luis de Leon Morales is in custody in ICE detention today, Christmas Eve in Newark. A member here, Luis, has only known this country as his home with a green card, a generous soul who for years fed the hungry in that room just behind me every Wednesday night. Luis, a man who now in his cell is doing the work of all of his compatriot cellmates who don't know how to speak English is doing the work so that they may have a chance on their trials. Lewis has been in a cage for months. Because why? Because we are hungry. And we have forgotten how to feed ourselves, never mind our neighbors. All that is holy begs us to come to the manger because the only antidote to fear is wonder. The only antidote to fear is wonder. Albert Einstein said this. We better listen because Einstein is brilliant, right? He said, "One to whom this capacity to feel wonder is a stranger who can no longer pause to stand wrapped in awe is as good as dead, as good as hungry." I'm hungry because I was raised on promises, and maybe you were too, promises like one nation indivisible, promises like give us your tired, your hungry, your huddled masses, promises like my Jewish ancestors told me when their boats were pushed from our shores, never again, never again. Promises like a Jesus chased down by a powerful ruler who took refuge by crossing a border. Who took refuge by crossing a border. And later, later, later came to save the world. I'm hungry because I was raised on these promises, and at times they taste like empty air. The youngest child removed from their family at the border was 4 months old. Oh, come, let us adore him. Wonder. The only antidote to fear is wonder, and wonder doesn't have a partisan name. And I'm gonna go hungry without wonder, and we're gonna go hungry without wonder. So come to the manger, to the border, to the barriers in all of our minds. Come and see the other. Cowardice asks the question, is it safe? Expediency asks the question, is it politic? You've heard this before, right? That other genius, that Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. Cowardice asks the question, is it safe? Expediency asks the question, is it politic? Vanity asks the question, is it popular? But conscience asks the question, is it right? And what about wonder? What does wonder do? Wonder doesn't have to ask a question because wonder knows. Wonder knows that it is holy. When we see the child, any child, bathed in the light of any star and bathed in the light of our conscience, and we give ourselves the space, the breath for wonder, wonder for one blessed moment, what child is this, and how will they save the world? There comes a time when we must take a position that is neither safe nor politic, but popular, not popular, but we must take it because our conscience tells us it is right and because wonder tells us that anything else would be abhorrent. We need wonder. We need wonder to feed us again. I need to look into your eyes and your eyes and your eyes and your eyes and know that you are the light of the world. And I need to keep turning and turning and seeing and knowing that none is born who is not the light of the world. Right? Because wonder is angels bending near the earth, begging and pleading, be not afraid. Right? What child is this? Come to the manger. Come and see the light of the world. Amen.
you sung was written by the Unitarian Edmund Hamilton Sears in response to his concern about the Mexican-American War of 1848. And we who fight the wars hear not the love song which those angels bring. And he was afraid that we had lost our sense of wonder. And he was afraid that we would become addicted to and self-righteous about the power we possess simply because we possess it. So we have gathered on this special evening to be witnesses, one and all, that there is a different way to be. That there is a way for us to look into one another's eyes and be moved and compelled and committed to a different way of being that doesn't see power only in violence and might and the position that we may now believe to have in this world. But a power that is more transcendent, that lives within all of our hearts, even when it seems distant from us. So in the spirit of another ancient sage, we, instead of cursing the darkness, we are instead going to light a candle. So I invite you to find the candle you were given when you entered. Those in the choir should have them under your seats. And if you need a candle, raise a hand and our greeters will bring one to you. I see a couple up here. If folks can bring candles. Why don't you go ahead and light that first candle, intern Antonia, and demonstrate. This is the safety part of the service. The lighted candles stay upright, and you light yours by bending your unlit candle to light off of your neighbor.
After your candle is lit, please hold your candle straight so your neighbor can light their candle. Like we just did. And then we will light without speaking.
After our song, remain standing with your candles lit for our Christmas Eve. Thank you.
go out tonight and look up upon the stars, just remember that that light that is bathing you has been traveling to you for a millennia just to get there. And that light that lives within the spirit, the person who is sitting next to you, who you might know or maybe you don't, that light that is within them has been traveling for a millennia just to get there. May that wonder hold you throughout the cold night and make it all the way to the bright morning. Amen. May it be so.